Hello, everyone. I have a quick tidbit for you about confounding variables. What are they? How do they impact research studies? And what can we do about them? And that's what you're going to discover in this short research tutorial video. So confounding variables, I mean, these are things that researchers have to deal with on a regular basis. And so we need to understand as consumers of research, those who are going to be reading research studies and hopefully incorporating them into our nursing practice. Do they influence things? Should we pay attention to them? Or perhaps you're designing a study and you want to understand what you need to know about confounding variables when planning and implementing a study. We're going to go over some of that here. So first of all, what is a confounding variable? There are quite a few definitions depending on what source you look at, but all of them share these main factors in common. First of all, it is a variable that is related in some kind of way to your study's key independent and dependent variables. For example, if you're wanting to do a randomized controlled trial or an experiment of some sort where you have an independent variable, which could be an intervention that you are manipulating, where one group of participants will get your educational intervention, and the second group, the control group, does not get the educational intervention, and you were wanting to compare outcomes on how well individuals understood a certain topic based on whether they got your education or not, that's an example of a quick, easy, randomized controlled trial for explanation purposes. So that's great. So my key variables for this hypothetical study are the intervention. Did they get it or did they not? And then how well do they demonstrate understanding of information? Maybe I'm doing a pre-test and a post-test where I collect some multiple choice answers for people before the intervention. And then one group is going to get the intervention, one group doesn't. And then I do a post-test afterwards to see changes in response and how well people now, hopefully, understand the information better. And my hypothesis in this example study would be that those people who got the educational intervention should have higher post-test scores and more change between pre and post than the group who didn't get the education. They hypothetically should stay about the same because they didn't get my intervention. If my intervention truly worked, that's the type of results I would expect to see. So that's great. However, there are some other factors that I need to pay attention to because perhaps there are some things individually with the people in my study that might impact how well they do on the test. Maybe they're just really good test takers. They might not have participated in my intervention, but they just know how to answer questions. And so they're automatically going to be able to narrow down the choices and pick the right answer, even though they may not actually know the content. Maybe they have poor vision and they can't read the questions well. And they really did learn what you taught them, but they can't see the paper that you gave them to answer the questions. And so that is influencing the results of your study. And so that, in essence, is a quick example of what a confounding variable is. It's some kind of extraneous thing. It's outside of my study. It's not one of my key study variables. When you read my research question that's guiding my study, you don't see these variables out there. Vision abilities, test-taking skills. That's not something I'm really interested in here. I just want to know, did my education intervention actually work with knowledge? Okay, so a confounding variable is related to the study's main actual study variables in some way, but it's not something I'm truly interested in. It's not in my main research question, and it's going to interfere with my study. I like to think of them as meddlers. They're meddling with the outcomes of my study. And so as a researcher, if I don't know this, then I'm going to potentially come to some faulty conclusions. If I don't consider the impact of confounding variables, I could absolutely think that my independent variable caused directly the changes that I'm seeing in my dependent variable, And that may simply not be the case. So I may come to poor conclusions. I may infer that cause and effect relationships are present when they're really not. And then I can absolutely over or underestimate the results of my study. So these are dangerous, and we need to think about them when coming up with study designs or when reading other people's published studies. Sometimes you'll see other names that are commonly used in place of confounding variables. I mentioned one, extraneous variable. Extraneous is outside. So this is kind of something floating around in the periphery of my study. It's not one of my main variables, but it's absolutely going to wreak havoc in my study if I don't think about it and control for it. Confounders, that's another name that you'll frequently see. And then there are some statistical terms that come into when we're trying to control for these things that you may see in study articles that you might read. Specifically, you would see this in like the statistical analysis section, in the methods or materials and methods section of a study, where they're telling you the types of studies that the statistical test that they're going to run. They typically will tell you, we treated these things as potential covariates. If you see the word covariate, that means that the researchers thought that that was a confounding variable. Another thing, sometimes depending on the types of testing that is being done statistically, you might see things like mediating variables, moderating variables, especially if they're running any kind of statistical modeling, like structural equation modeling and things like that. You might see mediators and moderators. Those are way more technical with statistical analysis. But I just wanted you to see a few terms that you might see in published studies if you are looking for confounding variables. That would be things to look for. So this is just a real quick pictographic reference that I made just to kind of show you what's happening here. So the independent variable is my main study variable that I am manipulating in an experiment. I'm giving one group some kind of condition, and the other group I'm withholding that condition. I'm treating them as a control group because I'm trying to see if the presence of my intervention is going to have an impact on my dependent variable over here. Those are my main study variables. That's what I'm truly concerned about. When you read my research question for my study, or if you look at my study hypotheses, those are the variables that are going to be the biggest highlighted area. The problem is they have to pass through this stuff called confounding variables that interfere with these relationships in some way or another. And so we need to know that as consumers of research, that those exist and they absolutely can impact the decisions or the inferences that we make about studies and what they mean to us and how we can use them to change our patient practices, basically. So here's an example. This is a very, very new article, Self-Efficacy and Autonomous Motivation or Associated with Lower Sugar Sweetened Beverage Consumption in Low-Income, Overweight, and Obese Mothers of Young Children. That's a mouthful, but I can see some of these researchers' key variables there. I can tell that they're going to be collecting data somehow on self-efficacy, the belief in oneself. Can you do something? Or succeed in some endeavor. So that's going to be one thing that they would collect data on. I see the word motivation or autonomous motivation. So more than likely, they're going to collect data on that as part of their study. And then it looks like they're going to be looking at rates of sugar sweetened beverage consumption. So that could be Kool-Aid, like sodas, like fruit juices, anything that's sweetened with sugar that we know has negative health benefits potentially, that's what they're looking at. So it looks like their main study variables are self-efficacy, motivation, and the amount or frequency with which people are drinking these sugar-sweetened beverages. And then we can also see their population that they were interested in studying there. That's the main variables. However, just hypothetically, there's a lot of things that can impact how frequently or if people drink sugar sweetened beverages. You know, sometimes the grocery store has them on sale. It's not something you usually buy maybe for your kids, but they're really cheap this week. And so we're going to have a treat. I'm going to splurge, clip my coupon, and go buy these things. So that could be a confounding variable. You know, presumably, shopping habits. Who's going shopping? How much do they know about nutrition and the importance of, you know, staying away from these complex carbohydrates? So you can see, I took a little snapshot of this study article. This is in the methods section of the study where it shows the design and how the researchers were going to analyze the data once they get it. And so you can see they have a whole separate section just labeled covariates. And you can see in this study, they were treating age, body mass index, education level, employment status, and race as this study's potential confounding variables. The researchers somehow came up with that list as potentially going to impact the number of sugar-sweetened beverages that their study sample was going to consume. And that makes sense. Now, just hypothetically, we're going to pause here real quick and say, can you ever possibly collect data on and pick out every possible confounding variable that could ever influence your study? No, there's no perfect study. We're never going to be able to study in such a tight vacuum when we're dealing with people and social science research to control for everything. That's impossible. So we're going to have some level of bias or error in our study, but we want to try to control for it as best we can, for sure. So as you might presume, based on the last example I showed you, demographics are very, very common confounding variables. I listed some on the slide there that you see very, very frequently in research, but that is not an exhaustive list. And not all confounding variables are demographics. You can have other things as well. It just depends on the research question and what your main variables are. I wrote a little caveat at the bottom. Researchers need to be very prudent whenever they are determining what types of demographic data they're going to collect. We cannot give research participants 300 questions survey to ask questions on every possible thing that could ever influence the study variables, because who wants to answer a 300 item survey? I know I don't, but if you see that's how many questions, you're going to decline participation in that survey. We want to be efficient in the types of questions that we're asking, but we do need to make sure we give very careful thought to what might influence our results. And we want to make sure we collect data on that in some way, because as you see here, what do we do about these confounders? As I mentioned, we have to plan for this. You have to think about what might confound my results. How do I know that? Sometimes it's logical, common sense kind of stuff. Sometimes you can talk to experts in the field who could tell you, you know, have you considered stress? Sometimes people's stress levels influences what they eat and the types of things that they consume. It could be a comfort issue for them that they don't usually eat desserts, but now because of either PMS or because they're uber stressed, now they're increasing their complex carbohydrates. So you can talk to experts. Sometimes it's just common sense, but a very good thing to think about is reviewing published studies in your topic area. What have other researchers used as confounding variables? Did they find that those made a difference or not in the studies that they did? If we look at that, if you're planning a study, that's a really good place to go to find potential confounding variables. And then if you see that, you would want to include that as data collection in your study so you can control for that. And this is way beyond the scope of this short video, but there are multiple different statistical tools that we can use to control for confounding variables. A very common one, it's called ANCOVA, or analysis of covariance, where we can kind of bring in these potential confounding variables and see if they are making a difference in our outcomes. Also, there's a lot of multivariate statistical modeling. I mentioned structural equation modeling earlier, but you also have things like logistic regression modeling, simple multivariate modeling. So that's I'm not going over all of that. That's not the focus of this video, but there are statistical methods that we can control for these potential confounders. And what that looks like at a very elementary level is if we think age is going to make a difference in our study's outcomes, we first have to have collected age. I need to collect that data. But once we have that data, we can use tools like on the slide to control for age and hold it constant, such as if age, we kind of take it out. If everybody in my whole study were 42 years old, then this is what the results would be. Again, that's a very, very simplified explanation. Any further explanations beyond the scope of this video. However, first, before you can control for it, you had to have collected the data. That's important. So, and I can tell you from past research experience that I have had at least a couple of studies that I've played a part in where hindsight, we were like, yeah, we should have collected data on this, but we didn't, and it's too late now. So that's just going to be a limitation of the study and do better next time kind of thing. So anyway, hopefully this was helpful in teaching you a little bit about what confounding variables are, other names that you can see them talked about in the published literature, some examples, and how in a very elementary way we can control them so that they don't wreak havoc with our study conclusions and implications. Thanks for listening.